Let's start with a question. What is the similarity between data and the air around us? If there's space, it basically fills up all the space. And with regards to data, it will fill up all your disk space. And it keeps growing, and the amount of data just goes crazy. So in order to find any information in this large amount of data, you basically need a search engine to dig into your structured and unstructured data. This also applies, of course, to Library and all the repositories that you might want to search on. So today, we are going to explore the new search features in Library DXP 7.1. And I will also show you some ways to use the Elasticsearch and the tools around it to take it to the max in your environment. In other words, where would you be without search? This is a small experiment. If you have a phone and you can do the QR code, you will get a small form. And I will use that information later. It's anonymous, so don't worry. If it doesn't work, then it's fine. So while you're filling in the small form, I will continue and later on come back to this. To get back to my original question, where would you be without search in Library DXP 7.1? Well, let me show you what will happen if you turn off search. So here you see a page with an asset publisher with some content. And if I go to the control panel and I show the users in the control panel, that's what you have. But now, if you turn off your Elasticsearch instance, what will happen? So let's do that. I just run a command to turn off my Elasticsearch service. And then I refresh the page with the users, and now they're gone. So your system is relying on search from the backend, but also from the frontend. So as you can see here in the frontend, the asset publisher is no longer showing you any, any information. So it's turning back on, but let's continue. If you look at Library 7.0, the first thing you got with Elasticsearch out of the box was this big fat portlet containing basically everything, so your search results, but also your facets or filters. It was a nice start, but yeah, things could be better. It was basically lacking some modularity, not only in the backend, but also in the frontend. But now in 7.1, it has improved a lot. The biggest changes with regards to search, if you compare it to 7.0, is mainly the big one, fat portlet, is now replaced by a widget, or basically multiple widgets. So you now have widgets like the search result, but also the search bar and all kinds of different facets that you can simply drag and drop into your page. So let's have a look how you can do that from scratch. So let's create a new result page. So if you start your portal, you will see a message up front that it cannot display any search results, and because there's no destination page for it. So in this case, I have the results destination page, and I have to create a new one. I create a new widget page, and I can do two things. I can create an empty widget page, or I can use the template provided when you install Library DXP 7.1. In this case, I create a new one, which is totally empty. And I give it a name as shown here, results. And once I have this empty page, I can obviously choose a layout, and two columns is nice. I go to the page, and there you see it's empty. So now I can add all my widgets on top of this. So let's first start with a result page. And since I already indexed some content, I can already search on this content. Voila. Next is to add some facets. So instead of this one big portlet, you now can add all your custom facets or your defined facets right away on the page. And once I've done that, I refresh the page, basically refresh the query, and it will be filled with the data that's available. So here you have it. So I have some content, but not all, that is tagged. I've created a custom structure for the DevCon, saying, OK, this is for developers, or this is for DevOps, or maybe some testing. And now I can also add my custom facet. And that's interesting, because there you can use also fields from your maybe your custom structures that you have. So to be able to do that, you have to know the name of the field from your structure. So I've turned on the details. If I look at this specific item, I look up the custom field that I want to use. So in this case, it's location. Is it the red hole or the blue hole, as you are familiar with? And I can configure that in my custom facet. So I put it in the aggregation field. Then I give it basically a label, which is location. And I give it a parameter that will be sent throughout your session. So I save it, I do a search, and now it's automatically populated. So this way you get a much more flexible way to set up the search results the way you like it and use it as facets. I have another one. So in this case, I use the day. So what day was the presentation? Copy the field and put it back into the configuration of the custom facet. Now, besides using I'm sorry. So besides using these custom facets and the fields that you have in Elasticsearch, basically, you can do much more, because Elasticsearch has much more functionality to it. So one of the things you can do is use synonyms. For instance, the same concept thing like a keying, queuing, precedent, or jump, leap, hop. It's something that you can configure within Liveray and use it. Oh, let's go back one. In this case, I showed you live. So here we have a live instance. Let me try to find the right field. So in this case, I have indexed some content, and I look for instance, English breakfast. I'm using the plus to explicitly say I want to find both terms. And as you can see, I find the English breakfast. But what if I would change English to British? I still find it, and that's because I use synonyms, and I've defined how I would like to map all those terms. So to do that, let's log in. I can quickly show you. And you basically have to do two things. So first, we go to the configuration, and I quickly to look over there. It's a little bit small. So I go to my search configuration. Then I have Elasticsearch. And here you have a lot of options, but one of the things that you need to do is basically define custom filters. I'm not sure, can you read it or? Yeah. Because here you basically create an analyzer for your synonyms, and you can add multiple lists of synonyms. So in this case, I've put in three, And for the English, I have put them here. So you have all kinds of ways to do that. Especially if you look at the Elasticsearch documentation, you can figure out, okay, how can I define those analyzers and filters? So this is the first step. So this is the definition. But then the next step is to also make sure it's added to your index. So to do that, you basically need the mapping. So you have field names within Liveray, but you also have field names within Elasticsearch, and there's a mapping file for that. And normally it's generated automatically by Liveray and stored into Elasticsearch. But in this case, you need to define it yourself manually. And that's done here. So you have to basically export it from Elasticsearch and then make some changes. And if I look here for synonym, you see that I'm using this synonym analyzer for specific fields. So that's what you have to do. And then once you've done this, you have to reindex your content because it will be applied to the index. Something about relevance and boosting. It is possible to make use of the boosting ways Elasticsearch supports. In previous versions of Elasticsearch, you could add a boost field in the mapping. So you could basically map it, add it to a certain field, but that's no longer supported. So now you have to make sure that it's added somewhere in the query. So if you're going to search on the title and you think title is very important, then you add the boost attribute and give it a number, and then the title field will be boosted. To be able to do that, you need to use the indexer post processor and customize the search queries. So that's basically how you can influence it. I lost my mouse. So besides the standard Liveray or Elastic implementation within Liveray, there's also something called the Liveray Enterprise Search subscription, and there you get additional features. So you get things like a plugin to show the Kibana environment within your portal, or to use the XPack security, which is from Elastic, to encrypt the connection between Liveray and Elasticsearch. So how does it look like? So this is the normal way if you install Liveray DXP or CE out of the box. You have an adapter that will translate the query from the user, or basically through the widget, to Solr or Elasticsearch. And then Solr will, or Elasticsearch will, store documents in an index. And when you do a search, it will send back the results. Then if you have the Liveray Enterprise Search standard subscription, you get additional features like the XPack monitor to see what the cluster is doing for your Elasticsearch cluster within Kibana. And also Kibana can be shown as integrated into a widget in Liveray. And then with Premium, and I think this is the most important thing, is the security pack that you get, because there you will get an encrypted connection between Liveray and Elasticsearch. And this can be quite important. for instance, if a hacker would be able to access your Elasticsearch environment, he would have access to basically all the data within Elasticsearch. And to add an extra hurdle, XPack Security will be encrypting the data between Liveray and Elasticsearch, but it will also add a username and password, so no one can actually get into the REST interface of Elasticsearch. So with this simple command, a hacker could delete all your data from Elasticsearch. And what about Where am I? Just a second. And what about GDPR? Because there's data stored in Elasticsearch, also user data. And if you're, are you allowed to let that open, or should you also make it secure? So something about Elasticsearch clusters. This is not from Halloween, but this is one of the topics that you see quite often with Elasticsearch, and that's called split brain. And it basically means that you can get into a situation where indexes get out of sync, and two different users doing the same query will get different results. So how can that happen? In this case, I have a Elasticsearch cluster with a masternodes, minimum masternode set to one. So let's suppose that the connection between number three and one and two gets lost somehow. Then the master, the node number three will think, okay, I'm all here by myself, and because there's only a minimum master node of one, I can elect myself as the master. But if Liveray would still have a connection somehow to this node number three and will send an update, then this node number three will basically say, okay, that's fine, give it to me, I will set it into the index. And at that moment, you basically have two different indexes, one with the cluster with 1, 2, and one with number three. It's actually quite easy to prevent, but that's also the reason why you always need at least three nodes, is that you set the minimum master node to two. So we have the same situation, but with a small modification in setting. So in this case, I have number three again disconnected, but this time he cannot make himself the master of his own cluster. And therefore, he cannot accept any updates. Some rules of thumb. We talk with Elasticsearch also, okay, what is the best scaling? Of course, it's always, it depends basically on the amount of data that you have. So they provided some rules of thumb. So at least you need three master entitled nodes, and they don't become all the master node, but at least there you can make a selection. You need an odd quorum to do that, so you can have 3, 5, or 7 if you like. I think most vendors say, okay, you need a dedicated host for your software to install, but sometimes if it's not that big, then you can still run it next to other software. Up to 64 gigabytes of RAM, 8-core CPU, and the 64 gigabyte is basically the maximum that you can give or you can use, because the heap memory will never be more than the 50%, so it will at most use 32 gigabytes. So no use in increasing that. Don't try to run in cross-region clusters, especially if you run in the cloud. You get latency problems, and then you can also get out of sync with your indexes. There are some solutions around it, and I know that Elasticsearch is also working on a supported solution, which will probably come in the next release or so. And there are also some benchmarks, so if you're interested in what is Elasticsearch capable of, you can go to benchmarks.elastic.co, and there you can find some more information on certain scenarios. Then the next topic, beats and logstash. So you have Elasticsearch, which is a component of Elastic, but you also have beats and logstash. And basically with beats and logstash, you can import data from other systems into Elasticsearch. And beats is more like a lightweight agent that you can install on servers. And for instance, you can transport Tomcat data or maybe other log files from this machine to Elasticsearch. And logstash is a little bit more heavyweight, but it will also give you some more flexibility to basically modify the input to the output. and filter it. it can be extremely interesting to use in cloud environments, because there you can automatically scale up and scale down. But what will happen when a node is scaled down, or if it fails somehow? All this data is suddenly gone, and you're not able to figure out, okay, what happened. Maybe you can see something in your AWS console that the resources increased, but why? You can't see it. So if you use Beats and Logstash, you can basically save your information into a different location and start querying it. And to be able to visualize basically your data, you need Kibana. This can be informative, so you can get some information on the data that you have in Elasticsearch. But it can also help you to see some anomalies. So what is suddenly happening? Is a hacker trying to attack your site? Or is there suddenly a drop on the login? So maybe there's something wrong with your system. And with Kibana, you can detect these kinds of things. I have a small demo on this. So this is Kibana as it comes out of the box. So I can go to my raw data. So this is indexed. And it's coming basically from different sources. So I have the library sources, but I also indexed the Tomcat logs and also the ordered logs. So I can use that. And one of the nice features is the dashboard. So I can set up all kinds of dashboards. Now I have to bend over again. Let's see. So I have here my DevOps dashboard. And it's saying it's empty because I imported the log files a while ago. So it's a time frame you're looking at. And in this case, I can see, okay, what is the number of users? Some info about the log levels. And as you can see, I have some severe warnings. And I can drill down basically on all this information. So interesting for DevOps. One other thing I tried. Was whether I could reuse all the information that was coming from the forms. And as you can see, you obviously added some information here in the form that I just asked you at the beginning. And I can display it. So I can use this to, basically generate reports. Okay. Now some indexing and search strategies, especially what I quite often hear is, can we also search on other repositories not stored in Library? Well, there are some ways to do that, and to show you a few. One is using repository search. So maybe each repository that you have, maybe a database or maybe some other system, has some kind of API, and with this you can basically create a custom widget for this specific repository. So that's one way. Of course, there are some disadvantages, because users will have to search in each repository separately to find the information. So maybe not the best one. This is an example for a job search. So easy to implement. You can do it one by one, but the user must search each repository. Then you can import data. So, for instance, you have a website that you want to include into your library environment, and you can basically import this data. I have a small example here. I'm using Scrappy, which is a Python framework, to basically import data coming from a website. I know some of the people around here will recognize the data, that I'm using because I use it for a proof of concept. So I just start a crawler. I have given it a starting point. And once it starts running, you will see that I get some additional data. So here it goes. Then later on, I will speed it up. It's basically the video that speeded up, so not my connection. And then I do a refresh, and as you will see, I will get all this content. I can also go to the content and view it. So if I go to a specific content item, I can simply see this content. So I can clean it up using Scrappy and just take some titles or some specific fields from my site page and store it as an asset in Liveray. And I can directly search on it. So that's a nice thing. So search works out of the box. Security can work out of the box depending on what you are trying to achieve. But you do a lot of replication of data. Because now it's stored in the original repository, it's stored in the Liveray database, and it's also stored in Elasticsearch, so three times. So what will be your single source of truth if there are some out-of-sync issues? Then there's the next one, which is federated search. So you can query, and then the federator will take this query to the different repositories. It's an option. I'm not very enthusiastic about it. The data stays in the source. You're using basically the APIs from the different repositories to search. But what will happen with slow systems? Are you going to wait for this result? So everybody is basically lacking a quick response based on one system that's slow? Or do you do updates in the interface dynamically? And what about scoring and sorting? How are you going to combine the relevance from one system to another one? And what about synonyms? How can you manage synonyms over all those different systems? And last but not least, and this is basically where I've been working at before I started with Liveray in the enterprise search, or what I now call it insight engines, is where you have a specific solution, like Coveo or Mindbreeze, and these systems basically do the same as Google. They index all the repositories. They basically leave all the data there, and if you're going to view documents or other data, then you normally go to the original repository, but then you build up one large big index, and you can use this implemented in a widget and use this as your search solution. So you get a lot of out-of-the-box connectors to all kinds of CRM, ERP, database systems. You have a single point to maintain all your synonyms and define how you want to have your relevance. It will give you the best user experience because they can still search within one environment and find all kinds of information from different systems. But it's complex to set up. And what about security? Normally, those insight engines also provide some way to map security, different security systems into one user account. So they do have some solutions for that. So this is what I think it looks like if you would plot it into a graph. So if you look at the development and configuration effort compared to the costs, and to the user experience, so the size is the user experience. So to summarize, search is a core component of Liveray, so also take this into account when you create an environment. Make it secure, especially if you have to comply to GDPR, then it has to be secure. Use the tools as you get them, also by Elasticsearch, so things like Logstash, Beats, and Kibana. They are pretty useful. And import and explore your data. So you can basically take some data, import it into Elasticsearch, and start exploring it. So you can see whether you can find some more interesting information. And in the end, make your users happy. So what will be your strategy? Would like to ask you to rate this session, and that's it.